do the damn
thing. Yeah, nice mute there, Richard.
We're not recording yet.
Or are we?
Hello and welcome to the Ritual Misery Podcast, episode beta 93 for Thursday, the 1st of September, 2016, recording live on diamondclub.tv. This is the show where two lifelong friends talk about geek shit and whatever else we want to talk about. Me, I'm Amos. That guy, that's Kent. And the dude in between, that's fucking Richard Gunther, man. He's back. He's back. I can't believe we got you back again.
I'm so glad to be here. I love this show. This is a great place to be late at night on the East Coast.
And we are we're a day late because Richard decided he couldn't do it last night. So he better not punk out on us like halfway through and be like, you know what? I just can't finish.
Well, I mean, it's a race, right? Do we get to the bottom of the show or the bottom of the beer first?
Fair enough. And now we know what the emergency was last night.
I am prepared. I have a couple summer adult beverages here with me. Just a few. Just, you know, one in a koozie because it could get warm while I'm waiting to drink it.
And now we know what the emergency was last night. Kent, how are you doing, man?
Oh, man. I am so happy to be here. It's a Thursday, which I don't think we've ever done a show on a Thursday, so that's cool.
I don't know. This could be the first Thirsty Thursday, and I can't drink because right after the show, I got to go pick up the wife from college.
Oh, man.
I know. Damn it. So it's the first Thursday show. We got Richard on.
You know what else it is?
What's that?
This is my 1 year anniversary of being a civilian.
What?
Seriously?
1 year ago today was my first day as a civilian after 20 years of military service.
Wow.
That's
it's gone ridiculously fast.
Actually, yeah. I crossed 21 years two weeks ago. So you win.
Yeah, I outrank you. I'm a civilian.
Yeah, no kidding. You're not paying my paychecks. Same as me, I guess. Yeah, man, how's the year been? Has it flown by? Has it been as exciting as you've ever dreamed? Did you smoke a lot of pot? What's up?
No, because I got a government job, so I couldn't do that thing. But no, man, it's been absolutely awesome. I was able to get a job where I got to interact with the same kinds of people, and we've got a mission that I feel is important. So my two favorite things about military service are still there, but I don't have to deal with, all the silly rules and the BS things that we don't like doing in the military. I don't have to do those things anymore, but I still get to do the cool parts. So yeah, man, loving it.
How's your week been, Richard? Shit, we haven't seen you in I saw you not too long ago on your show. Home on.
That's right.
So we need to do a little quick follow-up on that. But how's your week been?
Yeah, it has been a crazy week. I'm taking tomorrow off. Tomorrow is the Friday leading into our holiday weekend in the U.S., Labor Day weekend. And it's like that means I have to get all of the week into 4 days. So today was like a panic Friday. Today was me trying to get every last thing done before the week ends, but worse than a normal Friday because I had to make sure things were lined up and in place for tomorrow with me not being around. But I am really glad to be looking at a weekend, let me tell you.
I have a similar issue, except that I am on vacation next week during the 4 day work week. We have tomorrow off regardless. So I'm actually on a 10 day weekend. And yeah, so I had 4 days to shove 10 days of work into. So not quite the same.
Nice.
So Kent, are you working tomorrow? Do you got the weekend or what?
Oh, I've got a 4 day weekend, man. So this is like my Friday. So this is like the old days where I didn't have to work the next day. I can drink as much beer as I want.
Nice.
You're just rubbing it in there, aren't you? Just rubbing it in.
That's awesome. So apparently, this is just the way the show goes. This just proves that we're still in beta. Apparently, they're having issues seeing us on the live stream. So that sounds fucking awesome. This week I tried my damnedest to get an iCal to register on everyone's iPhones.
So like an iCal, like moo.
No. Like iCal is like calendar.
What are you saying?
Like internet calendar. You know, you go to like
calendar. I was thinking. Like a bovine.
No, not an internet cow. an iCal.
Okay.
I realize that trying to sync a Google Calendar onto iOS, you pretty much just wait until it fucking works because there's no way to actually shove it in there, and it really just pissed me right the hell off. It wouldn't register the appointments that were on there, and then when it did register it wouldn't show the details, and then it showed too much detail, and then it went back to not showing anything at all. Right now it's like this happy medium. I don't know what settings I fixed. I looked all over the damn internet, and they're all just like, just go here and click subscribe, and it's fine. Like, no, fuckers, that's not what I'm trying to do. One of those times that my Google failed me, and I just had to jacker with it for like an hour. So, that was super exciting, and that was pretty much my week. That's the most exciting thing that happened to me all week long was that, because it took like 4 hours of my time.
I just don't understand. I mean, don't you just identify your Google account and check the thing next to calendar and it shows up?
For you, yes. That's exactly how it would work. But I was trying to get other people to see a calendar from the Ritual Misery account. I was trying to share the Ritual Misery schedule with my family so they knew when the show was so they could route their plans around me being down here recording. Yeah. So that's how that was going.
Interesting. I don't know that I've ever tried that. Now that I think about it, I believe that my TripIt calendar works that way. I think I have like a feed or something to the calendar and it just updates it. It takes its good old time to update it, but that way I have all my trip information on my regular calendar. Yeah, the whole, calendar's weird.
Yeah.
So, Richard, just a heads up. We've been getting a fairly steady stream of questions for you from fans. So we're just going to kind of litter them throughout, like as they come up. So if a question comes out of nowhere, that it's not really from nowhere. It's a fan question. So.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, I'm sure. Okay. Yeah, I should have prepared better.
Well, we meant to include you on the circulation of questions.
I'm sure you did.
It's been kind of a crazy week.
Like the
so.
Twitter bait from the last time that I was on.
Oh, come on! Like we don't
that
do.
That was a lot of fun.
I don't know what you're talking about right now.
Not at all.
So this week, speaking.
But okay, you know what? Just to get it going, I am going to go ahead and ask you the first question just outright here. What is the most ridiculous hobby you have ever heard of?
So before you get into that, while you think about that, Richard, I'm just going to say that right outside one of the gates here at Elmendorf, there is actually the Anchorage Curling Club.
Oh, that's amazing. That's my favorite Olympic sport.
There's totally nothing wrong with that. I actually have a good friend who is really into curling.
Well, my thing is this, I love watching it. And so, but now I have a club that I can go to finally get the rules defined for me. Now, the problem with that is I think that part of the reason I enjoy watching it is because I don't know the rules.
Exactly.
Like I don't
exactly. You don't want to know the rules. It's it's more fun to just look at it and think, what the hell is going on?
Yes, and add to that the fact that I've never actually watched it while I was sober. Like I've never seen a bit of it without
right,
a beer
that's
in my
interesting.
Hand. You know what I mean?
I've never watched it drunk, so I don't know what that level of amazing that would take.
I'm here to tell you, it's a good time.
All right. Well, it wouldn't be curling because I actually think that's pretty cool. And I also had a really good friend who in high school was a championship fencer. Talk about another obscure
nice
sport. So hobby, I didn't really even go to sports. For hobby, I think the weirdest hobby I've ever heard of, not something that interests me at all, is I know of people who collect and basically mount and frame big dead bugs.
Now, is this specific to bugs? Okay. Or is it just...
What was that?
Is this specific to bugs, or is it just, you know, animals in general?
No, bugs. Like, animals in general, like, you know, the whole idea of taxidermy and stuff like that. I have a deer in my family room, actually. A deer head, not an actual full deer. But the...
Changes the context of it a little bit.
And a jackalope, because everybody has to have a jackalope, right?
Of course.
But of course. The bug thing just kind of creeps me out. I think that's really freaky. And while some of them can be really beautiful when they're nice and dead, I still think it's completely freaky.
I can't disagree with that. That's like extreme entomology or something.
Yes. Yes.
I don't know what extreme entomology is. Just entomology of it, like entomology for display is just weird enough. I don't know if you need to go extreme.
Oh man. So Dragon Con is going on right now, and I'm super upset that we're not there.
Yeah, totally. We had plans to maybe go there, and we totally, it just didn't happen.
Yeah, so. It couldn't happen. Richard, have you ever been to Dragon Con?
I haven't. You know, I don't have an enormous amount of leave each year. And so I usually end up going to technology-oriented conferences that are interesting to me. Or, I don't know, every once in a while, I remember back in my past taking vacations, too. And I haven't done that in a while, but... No, I haven't been to any of like the Comic Cons or Dragon Con or Super Fun Wonderful Palooza Fest or anything like that.
Right.
I want to go to that one.
Yeah. So you go to a lot of things like South by Southwest and stuff like that.
Okay, so that's fair. That is kind of a conference / party all in one. And
sure.
Your listeners know that you go and that we've been there together in the past.
Yeah,
we've been twice together, the three of us together. How many times have you been in total to South by?
This next year will, I think, be my 8th year.
Wow,
that's man.
So I've only been the 3 times. I mean, the first one where I met Richard, and then the last two years. So. It's pretty awesome.
Yeah.
Anyway.
Yeah. You know what? Now that I think about it, that might have been my first year that I ever went to South by Southwest.
Was that 2009 or
first year that I met you?
About 10.
Math on that would be about right, wouldn't it?
Roughly.
Yeah.
Sounds.
Yeah. But you,
that was 8 years ago.
I tell you what, it's like 7 or 8 years, but then you carry the beer and like it matches up perfectly. So, Hey, speaking of South by Southwest, all 3 of us are geeks to a certain extreme. So I have to ask, what geeky thing this week did you do, Richard?
I did a bunch of geeky things, so I have to pick one. So the geekiest thing that I did, and I mean, this is seriously geeky, like, you know, and you've talked about this on the show, so your listeners know that I'm way into home automation stuff.
Right.
And I'm always tweaking. You know, I really feel for the spouses and partners of people who are into this stuff, because we just basically terrorize the people in our homes, right? Because nothing ever works the way it's supposed to. I'm constantly changing it. So 1 week this button does this, the next week it does something else. And
Light switches are in a constant state of flux.
Yeah, exactly. Sometimes they work. Sometimes I have buttons that have labels on them that say they do something and they do absolutely nothing. And they've been that way for years.
But how often is it, or how fun is it when the family goes up and actually tries to use it for the label, but then it doesn't, and they think they're doing it wrong. Like, it's just amazing.
No, then
it's built in.
Then I just get shit. Then I just get shit. And it's deserved. I mean, it's totally deserved. So, you know, he's not going to let me get away with stuff like that if I just, you know, keep on messing with stuff. So this weekend, I ended up spending a good amount of time actually like redoing all of the keypads in my house. They're trying to make sure that every button did what it says it's supposed to do. And I got about halfway through the house. I still have a bunch more to do. And these aren't like, you know, I have a wall that has three switches on it. These are like keypads in the space of a switch that have like eight buttons on them. So you have to like program each one and make sure that it's linked to all the different devices it controls and what dim level they need to be at and stuff like that. It is a major hassle. And while you do it, lights are blinking throughout the house and the dogs are going crazy.
That's awesome.
But, it was a sense of accomplishment because I got a couple of them working the way I've wanted to when they haven't been working for, I'm not kidding, literally years.
Oh man, that's nice. That's crazy. Kent, you accomplished something this week.
Yeah, man. All right. So I love reading. I love reading pretty much anything I get my hands on, but I really love reading novels, and I've kind of cheated myself the last couple of years, not sitting down and actually reading a novel cover to cover. And I fixed that over the last couple of weeks. I think it was at last week's show or the week before I mentioned that I started reading Ready Player One.
Mm-hmm.
I finished it.
Yeah.
It's probably my favorite book of all time now. Like, wow. It's so good. Have either of you read this yet? Oh man. It is.
I tried to start it. I was given the book by a friend and I didn't read it. So then he sent me the digital version of the book and I didn't read that. So then he sent me the audio
version
of the book.
Yeah.
And I got about three or four chapters into it. And I know he's been talking, like, this is my best friend from college, and he has been talking about this for years and telling me I have to try it, and it's the best thing he's ever read. I'm going to love it. It's all this 80s references. And the audiobook's actually read by Will Wheaton. So it's a really good read.
Nice.
I couldn't get into it. I just couldn't get into it. And I don't know what it was. I really don't know. So I got to chapter four and I haven't gone from there.
Oh my gosh. Oh,
man. Re-engage. It's so good. I don't know. I was hooked from the beginning, but I truly felt like it just kept picking up steam as it went. And it just,
it could be one of those books that reads better than it listens as well.
Could be. I don't know, but I would love to have Will Wheaton read that book to me. I might actually pick that up on Audible. Like, that sounds amazing to me.
Yeah. Yeah, he does a good job. He does a good job.
Oh, man. I know. That's on my list. That and that finishing A Song of Ice and Fire. Well, catching up on A Song of Ice and Fire.
Right.
Ready Player One and The Hitchhiker's Guide are all like the top books on my list.
Oh, wait. You have not read The Hitchhiker's Guide?
Nay.
Get out.
Dude, you need to read all five books. You need to read all five books of the trilogy.
Right.
And there's actually a sixth one that was written by by the guy that like basically inherited the legacy of it. And you can kind of tell that it's not by the original author whose name escapes me right now, and I feel like an idiot. But
Douglas Adams.
Thank you. Of course. Douglas Adams, after he passed away, he actually passed on he willed the Hitchhiker's Legacy to Owen Colfer, I think is the author's name. He's a British. He's another British author. He did, I want to say, The Guardians or something like that. I don't know. We'll have to look him up later. But anyway, he did like the sixth Hitchhiker's novel, and he actually, I think he did a really good job capturing the voice of the, you know, the first five books of the trilogy. I don't know. It's a good read. It's worth reading. If you get through the first five and you really enjoyed those, granted, it wasn't written by Douglas Adams, but he does a really good job of capturing Adams' voice. And
nice.
I don't know. I enjoyed it.
Cool.
But now, I'm reading The Martian now. Have either of you read?
Yeah.
How heavy is that book, man? Like,
what's that?
How heavy is that book? And I don't mean weight wise. I mean just how thick, like how dense is the intellectual strain.
It's fine. Like it's like your favorite teacher that you've ever had ever.
Yes.
Teaching you like how to do math and science.
That is such a good way to describe it. Yes.
That's why I haven't read that one. That's why it's not even on my list yet, because in my mind I know how intellectually dense the movie was. And I can only imagine that the book is ten times
but
that.
Could you follow it during the movie? Could you follow what he's doing? Then you absolutely can follow it in the book, and probably even better. So,
yeah.
In fact, like the author treated this very lightheartedly, even with the heaviness of the science and the math. But he treated it so lightheartedly. The opening line of the book is, "I'm pretty much fucked." That's the first line in that novel. So that just tells you like what, like how like what voice it's written in.
That's awesome.
Really good. I'm only like five or six chapters into it at this point, but it's really good. Highly recommend.
That's awesome.
That I couldn't put down. I listened to that. I did not read that. I listened to it and I got through it in a weekend. I could not stop listening to it. And I was coming up with stuff for me to do around the house so that I could just keep on like carrying my phone around with my headset in and listen to the end of it. You will love that book. It is probably my favorite book that I've read since Crichton's Timeline, which is like 15 years ago or something like that.
Oh yeah.
Okay. So if you had to stack them on each other, Ready Player One, The Martian, and Hitchhiker's Guide. Which one's on top? Which one's on top of the reading list? If I had to pick one, because I do.
That's really tough. Well, see, I'm gonna wreck Ready Player One, just because it's more current and relevant, and I loved it so much. But The Martian's probably right behind that, and not to take anything away from Hitchhikers, but that's more of an investment. Because if you read the first one, you should probably read them all. And it's more of a time investment. So my personal rec would be Ready Player One, The Martian, Hitchhikers. What do you think, Richard? Obviously, you're not going to have Ready Player One first.
No, I'm not. My order is like exactly the opposite of that. I was going to say Hitchhikers because I feel like Hitchhikers is one of those books that every person on the planet should read before they're off the planet. Like, you know, this is like required reading for your life.
True. That is true. That is true.
Okay. All right. I'll take these into consideration and I will make a decision and start the book by next week.
Yeah. But I think no matter what conclusion you come to, I don't think there's a wrong answer to that question. Cause all three of the things you said are perfect. You won't go wrong.
So speaking of the books, I will probably read them on this.
Yeah.
This is my iPad Pro.
Damn, that's big, Amos.
That's the first time I've ever heard that in my life. This is the iPad Pro, the 12 point whatever. I got it because the opportunity presented itself to purchase it with some of the PCS money that came in. And after hearing all about iPad Pros and the multi-pad lifestyle from the Cortex podcast with CGP Gray and whatever the hell the other guy's name is.
CGP Gray's obsessed fan.
Seriously, it's just awkward. But hearing all the, just hearing the how much of a difference this little thing right here can be, and I got to tell you, I'm actually converting all. I noticed it was happening without even like intentionally doing it. But now that I've noticed it, I'm going full bore. I'm converting as much computing to my iPad Pro as possible. Like to the point of eliminating other things. I take this to work with me. This is how I take notes for meetings. It makes it so easy to keep track of things. I use it for this show. Like all the accounts on here are the Ritual Misery accounts, the Ritual Misery email, the Ritual Misery Twitter. It's like my work machine. And then my phone is becoming my personal machine. And I didn't even realize I was doing this until I went to check my Twitter on the iPad. And I hadn't even gone in and done the little thing to add my personal Twitter to it. And I was like, what the hell? Why isn't that on here? And I suddenly started realizing everything about this, everything for this podcast, like editing, the show notes, all that kind of stuff. I'm doing everything on here. And it's been awesome. I do have one minor complaint, though. And, well, two. Well, okay, so I have some minor complaints. One.
Okay.
One. This. Question number one. Where the fuck is...
For those who are listening don't know what this is, it's the Apple Pencil.
The Apple Pencil. Where the fuck has this been my entire Apple iOS life? Where was this? Because this is amazing. And I don't just mean as a stylus, because it's not a stylus. It's like you try to use it on any other device, it doesn't work. Which is complaint number one. I can't use it on my iPhone. I can't use this on my iPhone. You know how many times I've tried to use this on my iPhone? Like
that's actually surprising to me. Like, how is it not made of a material that the screen will recognize?
I believe that there's a layer underneath the glass on the new tablets,
right.
The Pro tablets, that does the recognition for that thing. So
I understand, but I mean, like, just the pressure from like simulating a fingertip, basically.
It doesn't. The pencil tip, it allows the transference of a signal from inside the pencil, but it does not actually convey the conductivity that a typical stylus for a touchscreen does.
Gotcha. Right.
So okay. And if it did, it'd be amazing, because then I could use it on here. Like, right. Why can't I use it on my phone? It pisses me off. Now, complaint number two, and keep in mind, I think this is the most amazing thing I've ever purchased from Apple. Complaint number two, the end cap on the back side of it. You use the little lightning connector on the back side of the pencil to plug into the iPad. It not only syncs it to the iPad, so you can use one pencil for multiple iPads. All you got to do is stick it in a little port, and it syncs automatically. Bluetooth-wise, it works. You can also charge it that way. Great. It's an amazing feature, because the iPad Pro has a very large battery, and to share some of that with the pencil in case the pencil does run out, fucking bonus. However, this little cap that goes over the end of the fucking pencil...
Stupidest thing ever.
Oh my God, is it? and it gets worse. Did you know that it comes like the pencil comes with a little adapter so that you can hook up another lightning plug that you'd normally put in your phone or in the iPad to the one on here? It's a female to female lightning plug that also is loose.
Mine is charging with that right now behind me. Yes. So you have that little part. You have the cap, which is a magnetic thing. It's ridiculous. It's absolutely ridiculous.
And
I don't know. There had to be a more elegant solution than that. There had to be.
And by the way, those two removable pieces, you can't buy them separately. If you lose them, you're fucked. They're just gone. Lost in the ether. Never mind. Forgot about that son of a bitch. Don't even think it exists. You can't get it separately. You can get the tips. You can buy a 4-pack of tips. But you can't
Why?
Get the cap.
I don't even understand what that is. Like, can do you write that hard?
On a glass screen? Like,
I don't get it. I really don't get it.
It even comes with a spare tip. Like, what the hell am I going to use that for? Meanwhile, I got to spend $10 to get a little thing that goes over from the pencil to the cap to make sure I don't lose the cap, and goes from the cord to the plug to make sure I don't lose the plug. Thankfully, they're glow in the dark, because I actually use it quite a bit in the dark, and I lose this fucking pencil, because it, as white as it is, it turns black immediately upon like lack of normal bedroom lighting. I can't find the damn thing. So
okay,
help.
So dude, if you bought them at Amazon, make sure you have those links in your show notes, because I need to get them, and people will want them, and they'll buy them, and it's probably like pennies that you're gonna get from that, but still.
Yeah,
that's
it,
a good thing.
And it was only it comes as a package. Both the little link things come as a package, and it's $10.
That's brilliant.
Like, but
that's brilliant.
And Apple doesn't sell them in the store or online. Like, come on.
Yeah, I don't get it. I don't get it. Have it in the show notes. That's 30 cents to you. Bing, done.
Yeah, I'll definitely have it in the show notes. That being said, and I know typically we would go straight into TED Talks right now, and you both have TED Talks, and we'll get to those in a second. But Apple has an announcement on Wednesday.
Oh, yeah. I already blocked it out on my calendar.
Oh,
I already
yeah.
told my client I am not going to be available between 1 and 3 o'clock on Wednesday.
I'm taking leave next week. Like, I'm taking the whole week off. Like, I'm prepared. But
you are seriously celebrating this Apple event. I mean, that's just crazy.
So, but the last one happened during exercise, and I couldn't watch it live. I had to watch like the recording of it, and then it just I got burnt out. So, here's the thing, though. This Apple event, I don't know if this is the Apple event that brought it to your mind, Richard, but your Twitter, you started putting a couple things on there. Little annoyances with some of the things that Apple has done lately. And it was already going through my mind. So I figured you and I could have a little concert of disapproval, and then maybe we can throw out a few ideas about next week. So
hey, before we get into that, a question just came in from a fan. Wants to know, Richard, who is your favorite podcaster besides Ritual Misery, of course?
Just came in. Just like that. Just came in.
He's got
hands down, Molly Wood.
Oh, nice.
Okay.
Good answer. Good Molly answer. Wood. Good answer.
Yeah. I have so much respect for her, and she's an awesome person.
I would definitely hold her in the top five, maybe the top three, but not quite top one. She might be number two.
Don't say she's number two.
That's mean.
Is it?
What? What? What do you? What? What kind of tations are you taking from that?
I don't know. But Richard, one more question just popped in. What body part is the one that gets the least exercise?
What kind of questions are these?
I don't know, man. Hey, these are Ritual Misery fans. So, you know.
What the hell?
I don't even know how to. Okay, I don't know the name for it. What's that little part of your ear?
Oh, the inner ear tab.
It's like kind of front, attached to the front of your ear there. It's just kind of like, it's like a little wedge into the front of your ear. That part, I don't exercise that at all.
That's awesome.
Oh my gosh.
So you could say you're not an active listener?
Oh, what?
What? What?
No. So back to Apple. I can't, well, what the hell's going on here? So,
I heard crickets.
It's more than what we heard.
Like one lone person in an empty room coughing.
It happens.
Oh, like, man. Like so that. About this Apple thing.
So you and I are both on the beta for iOS 10.
Right.
Right. I've got a lot of great ideas about iOS 10. I think they did a lot of things very well. It's really one of those changes that it brings about many additions to the iOS system that should have been there generations ago.
You do, do you?
Yeah. Yeah. Like the way that they handle the notifications on the with the swipe left, the way the control center, when you bring that up from the bottom, and you don't have a shit ton of controls all on one page. You can actually swipe to the side and get other things going on, like your home automation, your home kit stuff's right there, and in between is your media. I think they did a lot of things pretty good. I will agree with you on one very specific thing, though.
What do you mean you're gonna agree with me?
Yeah. Oh yeah.
What thing?
This home screen where you have to press to unlock after
you raise it up. Oh my god. How can you believe they fucked up that bad? Like, seriously, what the fuck are they thinking with the press to unlock? It does not work.
They added a step. Kent, you mentioned this a while back where you go and your 6S was working so fast that you didn't have time to see notifications or anything else on the screen. So you'd go to press to unlock it with, you know, unlock with your fingerprint, and it would just, boom, it was unlocked, and you're like, well, I just needed to see my notifications.
Right. Yeah.
Well, mm-hmm. Well, they fixed that.
Yes, they did.
Because now you can, they did. Now you can press it like 4 or 5 times, and you're not getting past that fucking screen. It just arbitrarily decides when it wants to actually accept your fingerprint and the pressing of the home button at the same time to actually unlock your device and let you in.
I used to end up triggering Siri all the time, and I'm still doing that. Because you're pressing the home button, trying to unlock it, and it's not unlocked yet. So I keep it pressed, and it's still not unlocked. And the next thing I know, Siri's on. So they haven't fixed the Siri problem. She still comes up when I don't want to talk to her. Yeah, I really can't believe that made it all the way through all the betas.
We're what, beta 7? Public beta 7 now,
actually
going
to hit goal. It's still in beta 8. So we have every reason to believe that's going to be in the Gold Master, which is just ludicrous.
Yeah. And here's the thing about Siri. I still can't get her to come on when I want her to, but every podcast I listen to triggers her. Even when it's being broadcast or being played from my phone, the podcast on my phone will play the command for Siri. Not even play the command. Like, play something close to the command for Siri. And now Siri's fired up on my phone, interrupting the podcast. And of course, then I cancel Siri out, go back to the podcast. The podcast skips back 10 seconds to make sure that I got caught up on it, which re-triggers Siri.
I had to turn off the call phrase because it was coming on all the time for me in the last version. So yeah. I haven't had that on for a long time. It works great on the watch.
Oh yeah,
because you have to actively hold it up and then you can call it and it works. So that I love, but I haven't used it on my phone for a very long time.
It's been really convenient on the watch, like raising it up, you know, saying the command and text my wife, I'm on my way. And bloop, 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 it's on. The message is on its way. You know, it's so, especially if you're carrying stuff, it's been great. I'm going to have to just turn it off on my phone. If I can turn it off my phone, it still works on my watch, I'm good. Cause that's really the only time I need to use it anyway.
But otherwise you're having a big love fest with iOS 10.
So what other complaints do you have? Because maybe you're noticing things that I'm not.
I actually hate the way it does notifications. I hate that they are so friggin' huge. I hate that they cover over anything that they're on top of.
Are you talking about the alerts that pop up on the screen when your phone's unlocked?
Unlocked, locked, whatever. I mean, like these notifications are enormous. They added a title bar to every notification. Like, how ridiculous is that? It's not necessary. It takes up more space. You can't see through it anymore. So if it, you know, it just, I have a photograph on my home screen. I have one on my lock screen. You know why? Because I like that photograph and I want to see it.
The thing that gets me is when you have an alarm set, if your phone is locked and you have an alarm set, the alarm just goes off. And then there's this tiny little spot, this tiny little thing where it says turn off or cancel or whatever. And you can't, like, you can press the screen five times on it and it never registers it. But the snooze is like half the screen. So you can accidentally snooze it while trying to turn it off.
I'm glad it's that way. I'm really glad that the snooze is much easier to hit than the off.
I would rather
otherwise I'd be accidentally turning my alarm off.
I would rather have an option to not have the snooze on there at all and just have off like really big in the middle, because I don't use snooze because it's a death sentence for me. I will just never get up if I have a snooze option.
You should look into that. You might actually have that option in the settings, like in the settings section. I think that might be an option. I think it is on the watch. I think you can decide not to have any snoozing on the watch.
Oh, I'm checking right now.
Oh, well, this is a good time to do it. All right. Well, while you're doing that,
Richard, actually, this is actually a really good time because we just got another question.
Oh, jeez.
So this particular fan wants to know, who is the one person you'd never...
Wait. Before you finish asking this, we have to add a little legitimacy to this, because otherwise he's just going to think we're bullshitting. Who sent this in? What's our handle or whatever that sent this in?
No, this is from Todd.
Todd.
This question is from Todd.
Is this like at Todd, or is this just Todd?
No. Well, this one came... I'm not going to tell you how this one came to us, but it's from Todd.
Okay. It's Todd. This is going out to Todd. Hopefully Todd is a regular listener to this show. So Todd, go ahead. Todd, you're on the air.
Well, we're definitely going to get his question answered, because I hope that he becomes a Patreon by going to Patreon.
Patron. He would be a patron if he goes to Patreon.
He can't be a Patreon. There's already a Patreon. He can go be a subable now because that one's gone, but he can't be a Patreon anymore.
So anyway, so Todd wants to know, who is the one person you'd never, ever send a Christmas card?
Todd.
Okay, I'm going to get way more personal than probably anybody ever would expect me to. My real father.
Oh,
whoa!
Something you and I both have in common.
Okay,
because that's
there
probably
you go.
The last person I would ever send a Christmas card to either.
Okay.
Yeah. Screw that guy.
Yeah. I'm sorry, guys.
I hope he listens to the show.
I didn't mean to put things down at all, but you asked.
So, what about your fake dad? Would your fake dad get a?
Well, yeah.
Your real dad, your fake dad, get one.
For the record, my fake dad's not getting one either.
A Christmas card every year, yes.
Yeah, my fake dad doesn't either. So, yeah, screw dads. Dad sucks.
Man.
All right, and so another thing that that we have in common, and when I actually mentioned this to my wife earlier today, and she was like, "Oh my God, yes." The fourth gen Apple TV. That remote.
Oh. Yeah.
so many problems with that remote. So many problems.
Oh,
so
man.
let's go over the things that we like about it. Okay, let's do that real quick. The things we like about the fourth gen Apple TV remote control. One, it charges via lightning cable, the same one that I use for my phone. It recharges.
Do we like that?
I do. To me, it's simple. I've already got the damn iPhone plug right there. I don't have to have a whole new adapter. I can use any of my iPhone plugs, and I love rechargeable batteries because I'm all about the environment when it's convenient for me.
All right.
So.
That's like my new iMac. My new Magic Mouse and Magic Keyboard are both rechargeable.
Yeah.
Plug them right into the Lightning, and boom.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm down.
I kind of hate that.
What? Why?
I kind of hate that because, okay, you must not be a procrastinator, because I am the kind of person who doesn't fill the tank until it's at or below empty, right? So I do the same thing with my battery operated stuff. I do not charge my devices until they're dead. Well,
but the beautiful thing is that I've got a lightning cable already attached to my iMac at all times that conveniently came with my iMac.
Ah, that's true. That's true. You do have that. So you can just plug that into the bottom of your mouse and then not be able to use your mouse.
Right. So when I discovered right? that I killed my mouse.
Okay, first of all, he's the kind of person that uses the mouse instead of the trackpad. Like, I don't understand that part of it. Like, I always use the trackpad instead of the mouse. Like, I got the mouse and I was like, okay, this is done. Where's the trackpad at?
Really?
Yeah, no, I had like another $50.
And why is that? It's more expensive than the old one. That's like back asswords. Why is the new one more expensive than the old one?
Because now it has rechargeable batteries.
It's supposed to be down in price.
And for the record, the battery covers on the old ones sucked. The old, the little twisted out with a coin shit. And I hate it. Because you know why? I'll tell you why I hate it. Because the batteries always ran out when I was drunk. And you can't replace those fucking batteries, that little coin operated twirly shit when you're drunk. It always lines up wrong.
You can replace the batteries. You just can't get that cap back on again. Yeah, right. That's the problem.
Yes.
That is the highest tension spring load I've ever seen on an electronic device. Yeah, that was a task.
How did he die? Quarter to the forehead. What the hell has that kind of velocity? Okay, so under this Apple TV 4th gen remote.
Okay, so you gave us one thing that you like. It's rechargeable.
I also like that I didn't have to program it for the volume buttons to work on my TV. And when the Apple TV goes to rest or sleep or whatever, it'll make the TV do it as well. I'm done. That's it. That's all I have.
That second part of the second point, you can't credit the remote for.
It's whatever.
I'll give it to you. I'll give it to you. All right. So let me start with the things that I like. All right. Now let's talk about the things that I don't like. Everybody's talked about this already, so I'm not going to get too in detail. But, you know, the fact that you can't tell the top from the bottom is fucking ridiculous. Just absolutely ridiculous. Yeah, they had to know people were going to use this in the dark.
Yep.
And it just so happens that the surface that you need to run your thumb across is the shiny surface, as opposed to the surface that has the exact same feel as that trackpad you love so fucking much. So that makes no sense. And then, like, what's with I don't get the button sequence. Like, I don't get that at all. It doesn't make sense to me. I don't like that I have to swipe for up and down. I don't like that I don't know from program to program if I have the ability to swipe through it or if I have the ability to go forward and backward. If there's a way to get to chapters like you used to be able to, I haven't found it. And to make all of that worse, I figured, oh, well, you know, surely the device itself, the Apple TV itself, will recognize the original codes and act on them from an infrared remote like
that was
gonna Harmony.
Nope.
Yeah. Nope. 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 Doesn't work on most programs on the new Apple TV.
What about using your iDevice, like your iPhone? Can you use the remote app on your iPhone to control it?
You can, and people who use that say that they like it. They've come out with a brand new one specifically for the Apple TV version 4 because it has more capabilities. But I need the tactile buttons. I need to be sitting there in the dark, not have to turn my phone on, not have to find the app. not have to make sure that I don't accidentally press the button that goes back and then piss off my partner who's sitting next to me because I just stopped the thing that we were watching.
Right.
I mean,
so
you know, I've ever used the app. The only time I've ever used the remote app was when I was standing outside the window of the living room and wanted to mess with my kids while they were watching TV. So that's the only time I've used the iPhone remote.
I actually enjoy using the iPhone remote app, at least the old one. I haven't tried the new one yet. The only thing I didn't like about it was the fact that there was no button for me to push for directions. I had to swipe. And now they built that into the fucking remote control. And it's so annoying.
The worst thing.
Do you know how many times how many times I've swiped past Clifford trying to start this shit for the kids? Like, oh, nope, go back this way. Oh, no, go back. But then my daughter picks it up and she can nail it every time. It just pisses me off. So maybe that's what they're aiming for. They're aiming for the 3-year-old market. I don't know.
Maybe they are. I don't know. But you know what I've been able to get really good at using? A friggin' set of arrows. They work.
Been doing it for years. It works every time. All right. Hey, gentlemen, I think it's about time to talk about some of this. You guys both watch TED Talks, and I'm going to start with Richard because I might have a chance of pronouncing this correctly.
Alex, yeah, even though it's spelled weird,
it is.
You're going to be able to pronounce it.
Alix Generous, How I Learned to Communicate My Inner Life with Asperger's.
Yeah, so this is a woman who is standing up in front of an audience and starting her TED Talk as if it were like a stand-up comedy routine. It's like she's giving a motivational speech or something, but she's cracking jokes constantly. Mm. And it starts getting kind of self-deprecating. And after a couple minutes, she comes out and explains that she's a grown woman of whatever age in such and such a career, and she has whatever form of Asperger's it is that she has. And all of a sudden, just the whole kind of mood just changes where everybody's just in fucking awe, you know, because it's like, holy crap, and you are standing on a stage talking to everybody. And so she essentially talks about what her perspective on life is like and how she has learned through kind of dreaming and enjoying things that let her feel free, how she's learned to cope with some of the challenges that she has with Asperger's. And she also talks about how she decided she's so invested in helping people do this and helping people overcome their Asperger's, she started a technology company, and the sole purpose of the company is to basically create technology to help people with Asperger's.
Nice.
And it is such an inspiring, I think it was 11 or 12 minutes. You know, it's not like one of these things that made me cry or anything, but it was just generally really a respectful type of a respect-worthy presentation, and give her a lot of kudos for it.
Very cool.
Nice.
And that I just completely, if you have any grammarians listening, they're going to correct you. Kudos isn't plural. You can't have a lot of kudos.
I know that. If we have grammarians listening to this show and they have
it's me. I'm the grammarian that's listening to the show, writing into you. You dumbass, it's not me and Amos.
No, it's Amos and me.
Yeah. Yes.
It could be, depending on how you're saying it.
damn predicates. I don't understand. Okay, so Kent, you've got
yes. Who is my TED Talk by?
Such an asshole. I'm going to go with...
He does this purpose now. This is not a coincidence. He does this on purpose.
It really is. Like, this is his thing. I'm gonna go with what I'm gonna do one day is he's gonna find a really good one. I'm gonna actually see it in the show notes, go and listen, watch it, and be familiar with it, and just bust it out like crazy. And he's gonna be like, "What the hell?" How about Ngozi Okonjo-Iweala? How Africa can keep rising.
Yes, that's precisely
not it.
Yeah, I don't know. Yeah, we're going with that though. No, this was a really good talk. So she was formerly the finance minister, the minister of finance for the country of Nigeria. And so she had a lot to do with the, like, I don't want to say the rebuilding of Africa, but like the, because you know, like how in the 80s and 90s, like all we saw about Africa is how everyone's starving and how it's just this, you know, desolate country of suffering people and all these things. Right. But in the 2000s, many countries in Africa started to like have an economic resurgence, and they were actually growing their GDP and creating jobs for people and things like that. And well, anyway, the African nations have kind of leveled off at best, and a lot of them have started to go back into a decline with their economic situations.
Mm-hmm.
And she came on stage to talk about, like, you know, identifying the problems that Africa's having and some possibilities for solutions of how to get out of them. And two things really struck me about her talk, well, other than the fact that it was very informative and interesting, was that she spoke such fluent English. Like, it was very surprising to me. She was using, or she was, ha, damn it, Richard walked away for this part. No, but she was using words that I had to stop to think, wait, what does that mean again? Like, her vocabulary was so enormous for English being a second language. But she spoke so casually, so comfortably in the language. That was one thing which to me spoke very highly of her I guess her intelligence and worldliness.
Mm-hmm.
And two, which kind of I guess falls right into the first one, is the casualness that she had. Like, she spoke with a professionalism, but at the same time, a casualness that I think anyone would feel comfortable sitting in a room to discuss issues with her.
Hmm.
And I just think, like, man, when she was part of the cabinet of the Nigerian government, like, she must have been, like, a very influential person. Because obviously very high intelligence, and also just the casualness of her speaking ability. I don't know. She seems very approachable, and she, like, if I was going to start up a government, I would want her on my cabinet. Like, she nice. Seems very strong, very intelligent, and very, like,
something you're not, because you haven't thought of it yet.
Exactly. The opposite of what's happening to me right now. I highly recommend it. Like, go check it out. If you want to know how to talk in front of people and exude confidence, like, go check it out.
Great example,
loved,
huh?
Loved this talk.
Awesome. Yep.
Cool. So, Amos, mm-hmm. What TED Talk did you watch?
I watched, well, see, the one that I watched is completely unpronounceable. But it was
so, like, all the ones that I choose.
Way worse than the ones you choose. It's you look at it and your eyes actually just blend it into the background because they can't comprehend the level of complexity of the names that I choose. That's what happens.
So it's almost as if you're not watching one at all.
That's a great way to really capture the essence of it. Yeah, that's really, man, that's
something I think we could all comprehend, though. We got a couple more questions in from some listeners.
Oh, good grief.
So So following up on the Christmas card question, Todd also wants to know, I guess.
Wait. Did this follow up come after my answer or before my answer?
It came after your answer, but it's also from Todd. So I'm wondering if it's a direct like result of your answer. It might be, but he wants to know, what was your least favorite Christmas gift ever?
A Christmas card from Todd. That's his least favorite.
Oh man!
Wow, that is really hard. I'm gonna punt on this one, and I'm gonna say that I'm sure it was probably, which means I don't really know, when I was younger and getting clothes, and as a kid, you don't want socks and pajamas and shit like that. You want toys, right? Yep, so
yep, absolutely.
I think it was probably don't like, give me clothing, know, usual stuff.
Don't give me clothing as a veiled excuse for you not having the money to buy me the presents I actually want. Like,
ouch.
is that wrong? I hope my mom doesn't listen.
All right, and Electro Boy wants to know.
Electro Boy, like what?
Oh, Electro Boy. Hey, they're our fans, man. Don't make fun of their usernames.
Or they're his fans. I mean, I'm not. I don't know if I would want to claim Electro Boy.
This might be Richard's fans. I'm not sure. I don't know. Crossover audience, perhaps. I don't know, but Electro Boy. Hopefully, Richard gives you a good answer on this one. He asks, or she? I'm not sure.
Electro Boy.
It's a handle, so I'm assuming it's a boy.
Okay.
Electro Boy wants to know, what song do you sing? I'm sorry. What song do you sing to every time it comes on the radio?
YMCA.
So what song do you sing along with when it comes on the radio?
Oh. You know what it is? What's that Mary Moe song? She don't eat meat, but she sure likes the bone. What the hell was that? Like, I can't not sing that fucking song when it comes on. Oh my god.
I can't remember the name of that either.
Mary Mo.
She's a vegetarian.
See, we know it.
I bet that's not Richard.
Wow.
Welcome to karaoke hour here on the RMP.
Yeah, seriously.
Oh man.
I'm having a really hard time with this one. I think we all know that wouldn't be my pick, but you know what? Okay. This is, I am totally showing my age, and this is so bad. I can't believe it. I am going to identify an 80s pop song.
Okay. Right down my alley. All right.
Which was big when I was in college.
Oh, okay.
And
well, now
in
you're
in college.
You know your age, really.
Yeah. Yeah. No, seriously.
Now you're killing me.
So it's a tie. And I think I'm going to go with Tears for Fears' Shout.
Oh, sweet. Love
nice.
That song.
Yeah, okay. I can see singing along with that.
Love
sure.
that song. Yep.
The other one was going to be Frankie Goes to Hollywood.
Okay.
I can't remember the name of that song.
Okay.
Oh my gosh. Yeah. Like now you just like.
Well, you know what I mean, right?
Yeah. No. Definitely.
Yeah. I
relax.
Relax. Yeah. Frankie say relax. It.
Yeah. Yes. Okay.
Yeah. Okay, I'll give you the Tears for Fears. I've never been a Frankie Goes to Hollywood kind of that song doesn't get stuck in my head very good, but
there's
Shout certainly does.
In 80s pop song that comes on, there's a really good chance. There's probably about an 80% chance I'm going to sing along with it.
An 80% like chance that you'll get an 80s song stuck in your head.
Just, good call on that, yes.
All right. Well, there you go. All right. So we're kind of at the end. You want to just any other questions that we have, just go ahead and just gang bust them out.
All right. Well, I've got a personal question for Richard.
Okay.
So my backyard, we spend a lot of time in my backyard grilling. We've got a fire pit out there. We have get-togethers back there and whatnot. The problem is I have no lighting in my backyard. I know you're a big lighting guy.
You can literally be anywhere in his backyard and piss, and nobody will care.
Right, because nobody will see it. Yeah,
and you want to change that?
No. As I was thinking about it, like, it's pretty convenient when you're drinking to just be able to, hey, here's a yard.
I would love to have lighting so that, you know, maybe we could play cards or dominoes or something on a table outside. Maybe if I wanted to grill at night, I wouldn't have to, you know, bust out a portable lamp or something like that. What sort of a lighting, like a general use lighting solution, would you recommend for me to install for not necessarily security light? I don't think I need security lighting, but just a general ambiance, like I'm hanging out in the backyard with my friends kind of lighting scenario. Is there anything you would recommend?
So do you have like a deck or a patio area?
I don't have a deck, but I've got like an area. So if you go outside of my back door, off to the side, there's like a grassy, I'm in New Mexico, so it's mostly dirt, honestly. But it's like a grassy area that's got an outdoor table, several chairs around it, and I've got a fire pit off to the side. And then just beyond that is my barbecue grill. So it's like a deck without actually being elevated.
And are there any structures there? Like, is there anything like I forget what you call a thing that's not like a trellis, but where it has like slats that are over you?
There are no overhangs or anything else. There might
nothing like that.
Well, I do have. So the first part is right next to my house. So I've got the roof overhang. And then over where my barbecue grill is, it sits right next to this outbuilding that I have. That's kind of like a miniature garage, basically. Okay. It's like an oversized shed that also has like a roof overhang.
So how far apart are they?
75 feet, maybe.
Oh, wow. Oh, okay. That's far. So
75 feet.
Yeah,
probably closer to 50, actually.
His yard's not that big. I mean, it's big enough for the dogs to go out there and poop and for you to go out there and pee in privacy.
Actually,
but
you know what? Now, hold on. Now that I'm thinking, hold on. Let me think.
Actually,
about
now that I'm thinking about it, it's really only like 6 meters. But
now we're talking metric. Now you're confusing me even more. No, let's
Sassian in the chat room says Kent would know, he's always out there drinking.
That's true.
it's really hard to judge distance
when you can't even see straight.
Put down a few.
That entire space, though, let's say no, it's definitely less than 50. So it's probably that entire space is probably maybe 30 feet.
Okay,
between the two. Structures.
I don't know that solves the problem, but so here's my general thought. Are you in an area where you get like bugs and shit when you have lights out, like moths or other kinds of flying insects?
We definitely get moths. Certain times of the year we will get mosquitoes, but that's very limited. It's mostly moths.
Yeah. See, that one of the real challenges with yard lighting is that if it's right near where you are, you're basically saying, here, bugs, come to me. And that can be problematic. So
unless you want to collect them and mount them.
Well, yeah, right. Actually, it could be a big opportunity if you have any friends that do that.
You just want to be creepy as hell.
Yeah, so I generally end up recommending either some sort of directional lighting that might, if your house has this sort of structure, that could be mounted like in the eaves of your roof line, so that it kind of the way that you would with security lighting, but instead of having it in someone's face, like over top of a door, have it maybe from a corner of the house coming at your conversation area from two different angles from your house, if that's possible. And if you have bright enough lights, it's going to end up kind of lighting up the area, like your whole backyard area there. But where it is, where you are, it's not going to be crazy bright. And that way it'll draw bugs up to it and not to where you are. The other thing, and the reason I was asking about how far the structures are apart, is that another thing that's kind of good and doesn't really draw a whole lot of bugs are those, I don't even know what you would call them. They sell them at like Target and places like that, like cafe lights, I guess I would call them. Kind of like a string of bulbs that look like bare bulbs, but they're clear.
Yeah. Okay.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. You know what I'm talking about? Mm-hmm. And in the store,
they're like the fancy version of Christmas lights.
Well, right. I was just going to say, in the store, they look like, oh yeah, it's just freaking Christmas lights. But actually they put out a damn good amount of light, and I had them on a screened in porch that I had before. And that was the only light that I had there. And I actually had to put them on a dimmer because it put too much damn light out on the porch than I really wanted there to be at night. So the trick is, are the places where you could mount it? Cause like, let's say you have this out structure and then you have two places on your eaves. So you could kind of create like a V between your house at two points and a point on the structure, or vice versa. Is that distance short enough that it's not going to be longer than one string of those lights? Because if it is, you're going to be fighting gravity in keeping that from right. pulling itself apart.
Yeah, you know, I've got the V area, which is actually really close to where we have the table set up. The closest distance between the two structures might be short enough. I don't know how long are the strands typically for lights like that.
So the ones that I had before were 25 lights, I think. And again, I'm thinking of the things I've seen at Target. Mm. And usually it's like a foot apart, or between a foot and a foot and a half apart for each light.
Yeah, that would probably, that could probably reach.
So, I mean, that might be something you look into. They look kind of cool. And, you know, they don't actually look like you threw Christmas lights outside, which can seem kind of tacky in August.
Sure. But at least we could see our cards.
But yeah, you'll have enough light that you can see your cards, and you know, you'll just have to venture a little bit further away when you go pee.
There you go.
Exactly.
Killing the buzz with this trans 25 meter journeys to pee.
Cool. All right. Yeah, I'll definitely look into those kinds of lights. Maybe the next time that you just happen to be swinging through Alamogordo, New Mexico.
Nobody swings through there.
Yeah, you're
the
right.
Next slash first time I'm in New Mexico.
slash last time. What?
Yeah.
Oh, geez. I don't mean to say anything bad about New Mexico. I don't really know anything about it. I've never been there.
That's all you need to know.
Hey, Albuquerque's really nice.
Sure.
Santa Fe is as well.
Yeah, we heard all about that. So we do have there's like five questions left that these apparently really smart people, because these are some great questions. I would never I don't know how you got these people to ask these questions. Like, I don't understand. But okay, anyway. So I'm gonna ask the ones that are pertinent to me, because I think it's actually a very interesting question.
Okay.
What is the
answering these, you or me?
You.
Okay.
I don't need to answer these.
Questions for Richard Gunther.
Yeah. What is the crappiest brand of technology products ever? And add to that, what is your personal worst case of buyer's remorse? Because I have a feeling they might be related.
Wow. Wow, those are good questions. Those are really good questions. The crappiest piece of technology is actually a technology that was OEM'd, meaning something that was made available to multiple manufacturers to put in their products. And this is kind of recent, but not terribly. And I am talking about Google TV.
Oh.
I think Google TV was probably one of the worst technology products that has come out in a good long time.
Gotcha. Yeah, because that was all the rage for all of like three people. And
for 3 months.
And I had one. I had the keyboard from Logitech that had the Google TV stuff, and I know Sony made a couple versions of them, and really bad. And I know people now who use Android TV and love it. And I am so soiled by Google's first and second terrible attempts at that I can't even consider looking at another one.
And for the second part of that, I'm going to go ahead and precursor this with my worst case of buyer's remorse. The thing that I bought and as soon as I couldn't take it back, regretted not taking it back, was the BlackBerry Storm. Like
you get sucked into that. All you have to do is try it in the store and see that it was a complete piece of shit.
I got it day of release. Like I was the first person in Barksdale or in Shreveport, Louisiana to have one.
Oh my god.
Did you like have to have a BlackBerry or something? And were you so opposed to the idea of getting an iPhone that you're like, fuck no, I'm doing anything but the iPhone. I'll do BlackBerry. They put out great phones. Look, they have a touchscreen. This will be awesome.
I was on Verizon and I didn't want to switch providers.
You could have gone with an Android phone.
I fell for the Storm hype, man. I fell for the hype.
Wow.
I think the worst buyer's remorse I ever had, I bought actually secondhand. I bought from some guy that I knew a Windows PDA.
Oh.
This was like just prior to smartphones really fucking hitting big. And I thought that because you remember back in the days when we had Palms, not necessarily the Palm Pilot, but
the like Palm Amos, 3C.
I know you and I both had the Palm 5.
Yep. The 5XE.
Yes. That was an incredible device. I loved that thing. So I got this Windows thing. I was like, okay, cool. This is modern tech. What a piece of shit. Like, I hate
Do you remember what it was?
I don't.
Because I had several Dell Axums. I had the Dell Axum X3 and the X5, and I loved both of them, and I wish I still had them.
Really?
Like, yeah.
Windows CE was so clunky, and I don't know. I didn't like it.
This was Windows Mobile. Like, Windows... I remember what it was called. I think it was called, like, Windows Mobile... I don't remember what version it was.
The device I had was on Windows CE.
Yeah, before it was called Windows Mobile, it was called Windows CE, and it came on, they were called a number of different things, but Palm made one and a bunch of different manufacturers like HP and...
I think HP was the brand that did mine.
And Compaq made some before HP bought Compaq.
The Compaq one, man, I thought that was one sexy little machine. Had a little flip cover,
Had that.
A semi-transparent flip cover thing, and man, that thing was was it the Presario? No. Oh, what was that called?
Was it the iPack? I had the iPack.
Yeah, the iPack. Which was not the iPhone, by the way.
Yeah, no.
iPack, a.k.a. the iCrap.
Oh, my gosh.
At the time, it was pretty freaking cool. I had the Casio Cassiopeia, an early monochromatic black and white, four colors of black.
Four shades of shitty orange. Or
actually,
of shitty
actually,
green.
I shouldn't say that because one of the colors was no color. It was like, it was black, less black, even less black, and no color at all. That was your that was your color options on it, and it was Windows CE. It was, and I was like, this is awesome. This is Windows on a thing that fits in my hand, and the damn thing probably couldn't even turn on now if I tried. I probably have it somewhere.
Oh man,
I'm still.
So what was your what was your biggest case of buyer's remorse though?
Yeah, that's what I'm trying to figure out. I have a hard time thinking of this one.
Are you just that careful with your purchases, or have you had so many that you know, it's hard to choose?
Right.
I think it's that, like, I'm a material person, and I love gadgets, and I'm an early adopter. And I'm fortunate enough that in my current situation, I don't have kids. I can spend my money on me. Mm. And so I buy a lot of shit. And sometimes as an early adopter, I'm like, you know what? Sometimes it works out and sometimes it doesn't work out. And I just kind of have to suck it up and deal with that. I think of anything that I've spent any significant money on, I'm going to have to go way, way, way back. I'm going to go back to when I was in college again.
Oh, listening to
the 80s. Back to the 80s again.
Back to the 80s. I love the 80s.
Hey, don't knock the 80s, man. The 80s were amazing.
I mean, how many colors can you stack up, right? You know, just one, top one, two, three.
There's a limit depending on how cool you are.
Yeah, that's true. I wasn't cool enough. So I bought a computer with my first credit card for Sears before I was out of college.
Did it cost you $8,000?
It did not. Now, this was back in the day of the Commodore 64. I'm sure you've heard of that computer.
Windsor,
yeah, I've used it. Thanks.
Have you? Okay.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm a kid. We're 80s kids.
All right. Okay.
When you were
I had a Commodore 64. And when I was in college, I decided for some reason that I needed the newer, better computer that they were coming out with.
Mm.
So I went and I bought the Commodore 128. And
that classic.
That one I don't remember. I don't remember the 128.
Right. Right, exactly. And put myself in debt while I was still in college, barely making any money, with a computer that, other than the fact that it showed 80 characters on the screen instead of 40 characters on the screen on each line, wasn't substantially better than the one that I had. And while I continued to like learn programming and stuff like that and log into my computer network at school, I could have done all of that shit with the perfectly good computer that I had and not have started a debt spiral that followed me for the next easily 10, 15 years.
So I'm going to have to revise mine, by the way, for almost, for almost the same reason. My first credit card purchase was at Sears. It was a web TV. In 1996.
Oh, dude. Yes, you win.
and the hundreds of dollars of telephone calls that followed because I had no local node in Shaw Air Force Base, South Carolina.
That's awesome. Yes, you win.
Oh, man. So there's that.
My first web pages, I downloaded a web TV emulator. just so that my web pages would be compatible with as many browsers as possible.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. Absolutely. Yeah. In, I mean, at that time, I was actually managing a very large government team of people who built one of the cabinet agency's websites and maintained it. And this was around 2000. And we had in our toolkit basically a web TV emulator, because we had to make sure that our content was accessible on web TV devices, because we knew that there were people that were trying to get help from the government, that that was the only way they had access to the internet.
That's amazing.
Right. That was the early days. And then Microsoft bought it and became MSN TV.
I don't know. I stopped using it after the third
phone
bill.
Very nice. Yes, that's correct.
I stopped using it after the third phone bill.
All right, so
let's move on. Real quick. Speaking of the 80s, in 1985, I turned 8 years old. I would like to know if you could wrap up in one word, describe your eighth birthday. Kent, go ahead.
Oh my God. So my eighth birthday, what would that be? Third grade? 8 years old. Is that third grade?
I can't math.
Holy crap. So my birthday is in July. So it's always over the summer and it's always during 4th of July weekend. So, oh man, I'm sure, because back then I always had a bunch of friends over. I say a bunch. So like probably four or five friends would come over. We would do cake and play games and shit. And then we'd go watch the fireworks. That was like a typical birthday for me. So
you heard the instruction, one word.
Right. Yeah. I was wondering if you heard that as well. One word.
Yeah. Well, I'm just trying to think what could describe my eighth birthday. I'm going to have to go with fun.
Okay.
That's gotta be it. I gotta say fun.
Richard.
I'm going to have to go with spoiled.
Okay. All right. That's fair.
I was an only child and an only grandchild, and my grandparents just spoiled the shit out of me when I was a kid and made sure that I had an awesome birthday every single year.
Nice.
So much makes sense now.
Nice. I'm going to have to go with forgettable, because I have no idea what the hell I was doing in 1985 when I turned 8 years old.
Well, yeah. I mean, it's not like Kent and I just actually remembered that day.
No, that's just it. Well, I mean, you can go, but specific to your birthdays, I can go fifth grade. Five years old. I remember that because it was a surprise party at McDonald's. Okay, cool. And then you go, the next birthday that I actually remember doing anything on is like my 11th birthday. Like there's a huge gap of birthdays there that I just, no idea. Did we celebrate that year? I'm not sure. Like,
I think you had a much more memorable life than I did, because I sure as fuck can't remember birthdays in my single digits.
Yeah, not so much. Just general feelings of that time period is really about all I get.
Wow. Yeah. Okay. Well, there you go. So, I guess that question wasn't as fun as I thought it would be.
But you know what? Here's a fun one. So, Richard, what part of your house is most likely to be haunted?
While he thinks about that for a second, I'm just gonna say I just bought a new house, and I got to tell you, my stairway downstairs, the one that goes from the main floor to the basement, has got to be fucking haunted, because it didn't matter what time of day it is when I'm going back upstairs. If I'm the only one person down here, I get a little freaked out. So, just saying.
Nice.
Just thinking about this is kind of freaking me out a little bit.
He's suddenly realizing that half of his house is fucking haunted.
Well, no. So, I mean, there's a story behind my house.
Oh, shit.
Dun, dun, dun.
And the builder who built the house for him and his wife. And his wife died during the time that they were building the house. Not, as far as I know, at the house. Or did she?
Dun, dun, dun.
Dun, dun, dun. All right. I'm just going to go with... I'm going to say the basement, because we have this crazy industrial furnace thing in the basement that is really cool, but also just really creepy because of all the noises that it makes and everything. And there's all so much going on down there that it's easy to kind of creep yourself out by a noise that you don't hear, even though it's a big, bright, open space. It's like, if you hear something that you'll recognize.
Do you... Imagine that exact scenario you just described, except not being a bright place. Being a dark, dank. My grandparents' house, they had a big furnace in the basement, and I would go downstairs because Grandpa had a pinball machine down there.
Yep.
So I would go down in the basement and play that damn pinball machine, but it was so fucking dark. There was a single light bulb hanging from the ceiling that provided light.
Did it constantly sway just ever so gently?
It did.
Back and forth?
It did. And every fucking time that the furnace would kick on, I would get so freaked out. Half the time I would run back up the stairs and be like, yep, I'm done playing pinball.
So essentially none of us like basements. Got it.
Okay.
I was scared to death of my grandparents' furnace. That thing was huge and made all kinds of crazy noises, and there was fire in it. It was scary. I did not like that thing at all.
That's amazing.
Amazing. Definitely. It's a shared experience. That's so true. All right, Richard, what is your favorite science fiction mode of transportation?
Oh, tell me it's a ring. 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 Tell me it's a ring.
Tell you it's what?
A ring.
A ring?
Yeah.
Oh, like a teleportation ring?
Yeah.
Well, that's not exactly where I was going. I was going to say the transporter. I think the concept of the transporter is really cool. If it were scientifically possible, I would probably try it.
You're talking about the Star Trek teleporter, right?
Do you watch a CGP Grades videos at all?
Wait. Are you a Star Trek person?
Me?
Wait, who?
Kent?
Yes, I love Star Trek.
And you called it a teleporter?
No. I was explaining to the people that don't know what the transporter is.
Do you think there are people who listen to your podcast who don't know what a transporter is?
I don't
think there's people that listen to this podcast.
Know that a transporter the device that teleports people. Sir, honestly.
Oh, man.
We'll wait for her response. But I guarantee there's people that don't know the teleporter. I'm sorry, the transporter is a teleporter.
Okay.
Okay, the answer was fuck off. So I'm pretty sure she did not know that. unless you...
She also called you a fucktard, so I'm pretty sure that, you know, there's that. Do you watch CGP Grey's videos at all, Richard?
No.
He just recently put one out, well, I say recently, probably about 3 months ago, about how you die every time you're on the Star Trek transporter. And it's very, very interesting to watch. And I'll put a link to that in the show notes as well. It's a very, very fun video to watch.
Well, and I mean, there, it's funny because as I said that, I'm like, I know that there's people who would believe that if you ever use the transporter, you basically lose your soul, right? Like there's the concept of a transporter isn't possible because you wouldn't actually go with your body.
Right.
I don't really believe that. So there you go. There's an added answer that nobody was expecting.
Right, but do you think your actual molecules that make up you are traveling, or is it just creating a copy?
Who's to say that it's actually you being transported and not everything around you being modified to fit what you think your new locale is? Matrix, anybody?
Okay. Like, all right. See, that was...
We could have an entire couple of hours talking about the theory of the transporter.
That's true. That is true. All right. So instead of doing that, let's move on. So just a couple. I think there's only two more.
There's just like seven more. Don't worry.
All right. 18 more questions. Starting with, what is the stupidest article of clothing you've actually seen someone wear?
And you can't say it's my 49er sweatshirt.
He could. But
I guess he could.
I think it has to be that fucking shirt that Richard Simmons wears.
You mean his workout shirt, the striped tank top thing?
Shiny, sleeveless.
Yeah.
Skin tight.
Yeah, I think that's it. I can't think of anyone off the top of my head that would come to mind as quickly when you say looks ridiculous. Yeah,
my favorite thing that he was ever part of was when he'd go on the late night show or whatever, the late show with David Letterman, and every time he'd go on that damn show, David Letterman would get the fire extinguisher and chase his ass off with it.
God damn. Okay, all right. One last question, Richard, and then we'll wrap this up after this. Question. So what habit do you have while you're trying to concentrate? Maybe just something that you get yourself in the mindset to like figure out a problem. Like what do you do when you're trying to concentrate?
I pace.
Pace.
Yeah. Okay. I'll like when I really need to think something through, I'll get up and walk around my office. And I think I told a story about me getting up and walking around my office with a headset on a video call.
Oh,
at one point.
Yes. Yes.
When I was on this show before.
Two or three.
And I was just so in the thinking zone while I'm on this call that I totally forgot about the fact that I was on a video call. Start scratching myself.
Yes. I do the same thing when I'm on a phone call. I can't imagine if I was in a position to do a video call for work or something. Like, I don't. If I'm on my cell phone, like I'm probably pacing.
For the record, we keep post show conversations private because we end up having conversations after the show is over and we stop broadcasting it. Oftentimes should never be known in public. So, yeah, you have to forgive me if I didn't remember that one until you reminded me because I try to wash those out so I don't accidentally say something later.
Yeah. All right.
Man.
So anyway, so what we did today, Richard, was we harvested your answers to all of our fan questions, and we. Put it together. We put your answers into some blank spots that we had in a pre-written story.
Oh my God! It's like Gunther Mad Libs.
That's right.
Yeah.
And we're gonna read it. Amos, do you want to read it or do you want me to read it?
I'll read it.
You gonna read it? Okay. All right. So here we go. The Richard Gunther.
Should this be a dramatic reading or just a narrative?
Not overly dramatic. Let's do a general prose read with a little bit of inflection and feeling.
So you just want some flair?
Just a little bit, though, not a lot.
All right, here we go.
That's coming out in post, right?
No, definitely not.
you said post.
Like we have a... Yeah.
Okay, here we go. Richard never knew how good life could be until he got... There we go.
Well, you failed, so here I go. Go ahead, Amos. Take two.
Richard never knew how good life could be until he really got into bug mounting. It all started on his 7th birthday when he got the tattoo of Molly Wood on his ear. While any lesser man would simply tell his friends and maybe send a few Snapchats, Richard ran home and immediately told his dad. Impressed with the new branding, his dad immediately cooked him up a cup of sock noodle soup and began singing, "Shout, shout, let it all out." Unfortunately for Richard, the singing woke his dog and it began to pace ferociously while nipping at Richard's heels. Being chased around the house is no fun for Richard, so he tried hiding in the basement. There he discovered a teleporter to another world called Google TV Land. The Google Land citizens, called the acolytes of the Commodore 128, greeted Richard with open arms until he saw the new tattoo. Tattoos of Molly Wood were sacred signs in Google TV Land. The acolytes of Commodore 128 deified Richard and blessed him with his many Richard Simmons shirts. And now he has returned to us to us here on Earth to tell us about all the places you can listen to his amazing spoiled wisdom. So, Richard, where can fans find more of you?
I have to recover first. All right. Wow, that was unexpected. I am on Twitter, and I have a number of voices there, but the easiest thing to do is just follow Richard Gunther. That aggregates all the other voices. So if you might notice that Richard Gunther retweets other accounts, don't follow my other accounts. You don't have to. It's all there. It just happens. It's magic. I pay some service to do that. It's wonderful. I also have
he has people.
Also, I think thinking about paying for that service, but
but just to be clear, it's my tweets. It's just the aggregation. Okay, anyway.
Yeah.
I host two podcasts. One is called Home On, and Amos, you've been on that one. We talked about your new home and getting you set up, and I understand you're buying stuff now for your new home, which is kind of cool. We'll have to do a follow up at some point.
I love my Ecobee.
I love my Ecobee.
I think it's just amazing.
Great system. Yep, absolutely. And I also host a podcast called Entertainment 2.0. I co-host that actually with a colleague, Josh Pollard, and we geek out on Microsoft entertainment technology. Yes, believe it or not, there is more to be entertained by in the Microsoft world than just the Xbox. So we talk about what's going on in that space. And there are two more places that if you're listening, you might get a chance to hear me. And that is in two sessions at next year's South by Southwest. I am proposing a panel, and I have also been asked to co-host a session with someone. And those two panels are right now in South by Southwest's panel picker. Now, here's the thing. If you're listening to this show just over audio because you got it off your feed, too late. I hope it got picked. I hope it got picked. But if you're listening now, like if you're actually one of the one people, no, I think there's more than one people. If you're one of the people that's listening as we're recording this, you can go now, right now, because today and tomorrow, Friday, the day after we're recording this, actually, it's already Friday. All right, you have one day left.
Friday, depending on what coast you're on.
Friday is the last. All right. Oh, time is so confusing. Last time that you can vote for these panels. So the way this works is you suggest stuff, people have to vote it up or vote it down, and then things that get voted up the most, the advisory board then considers to include in next year's South by Southwest panel lineup. So I would love it if while you're listening, and while I've been talking, you probably already could have done this. You go to panelpicker.southbysouthwest, that's SXSW, hard to say, .com, and you have to log in. It's going to ask you to log in. And if you don't have a login because you haven't been to South by Southwest Doesn't matter. You can create one. It's really easy. You can log in with your Facebook account, or you can create an account. It's really fast, really simple. You don't have to go to Southwest. Give me those thumbs up for my two sessions. I would greatly appreciate it. I know that was a really long pimp, but I am so excited about the opportunity to speak at South by Southwest. I haven't had a chance to speak there yet, and I hope it happens.
No, that would be absolutely incredible, and that would be one of the few things that would cause me to buy a badge or purchase the badge for South by would be to see you speak. That would be phenomenal.
I am not worth paying $800 for a badge.
Up to $800 for...
Well, I forget what it costs now. I think they raised the price of the single conference badge. Yeah.
It's if it's $800, then I love you, Richard, but...
Right. No, it's ridiculous. It's absolutely ridiculous.
That's not even considerable. If it was $800,
we could have gone to DragonCon for 3 days for $800.
Oh, exactly. And had changed that and drinking money. Oh man, where are you at, Amos?
Just Ethan Kane on Twitter. ETHANCAINE. That's it. Just go there and I put my feet in my mouth all the time on there, just like this show.
Right.
So it's an occupational hazard being an asshole in a lovely world.
You go to @RM_DelNoche, you can follow me, and I'm always trying to be funny or insightful, mostly funny. I don't know how well I do on there.
Keyword.
But go there, follow me, check me out, like or comment. That would be awesome. If you're a beer guy like me, you can go to ratebeer.com, read my reviews. Username DelNoche is how you find my reviews.
We're on a mission to count down to episode 100 of the Ritual Misery podcast. And right now, this is episode beta 93, and beta 94 will be coming next week. And who do we have lined up for next week, Kent?
We are welcoming back to the show the great Jackie Hearn.
Oh,
awesome.
Jackie Hearn coming back to the Ritual Misery podcast. That should be fun. Last time she was on, she co-hosted and kind of outshined you there a little bit, Kent. You might need to step up your game next week.
No, that's absolutely true. Yeah, she tried to perform a coup.
Yeah.
Try
to steal your show. Well, she definitely stole your show. She tried to steal the show.
Oh, exactly. So. Yeah. Ultimately, her attempt failed, but I think she was very successful in the moment.
I'm sure she learned lessons from it, though. So, you know, now she's got experience.
Well, she didn't learn a whole lot from it because she's coming back.
Well, there you go.
I can't wait. I always love talking to Jackie. She's fantastic.
And of course, if you want to ask our next guest some questions, completely off the wall, random stuff like that, cruise on over to the subreddit, ritualmisery.reddit.com. Throw your comments and suggestions in there, and we will figure out how to include those on the show and perhaps embarrass some other future lucky, unlucky guest. So let's make that happen. You can email us, podcast@ritualmisery.com. You can call and leave us a voicemail, 567-69-TRMPC. That's 567-698-7672. And, of course, you can find all these and more ways to support the show at ritualmisery.com. Cruise on over there, buy some swag, throw some Patreon money, whatever helps. We're actually doing pretty good on that. We really appreciate that. Thank you so much to Kevin McLeod for allowing us to use your music. And thank you for listening. For Kent, I'm just going to let it go. For Kent, for Richard, and for me, this has been your Ritual Misery Podcast.
Diamond Club hopes you have enjoyed this program.
Man, that music came... That really, really killed her pretty quick.
Came with the thunder.
It did. Like it was just there. Like I hit the button and all of a sudden it's just loud in my ears and I was like, I'm out of time.
It's like a train coming at you.
Oh man. So other than the technical problems, I thought it was a pretty fun show.
It was fun. I think
it was fun.
Bit when we were going Apple for.
Yeah, we did, and we didn't even get to talk about. Like, what's going on. Because we were going to potentially make some guesses on what we were going to get.
Yeah.
Yep, we were. Oh, my God. We'd still be going. And our the whole Apple segment probably would have been about 45 minutes on its own if we'd have done that.
Yeah, yeah. If I were a producer to actually spend some time in post, I could probably trim that down to about 15 minutes.
Definitely. But that's like a job.